बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। अस्सलाम वालेकुम डियर स्टूडेंट, माय नेम इज़ डॉक्टर मोहम्मद अदनान असगर एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट कोवलेंट बॉन्ड इन बॉन्डिंग इन सॉलिड्स। एज वी नो दैट वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस द डिटेल्स ऑफ आयनिक बॉन्ड इन डिफरेंट कंपाउंड्स सो फार, सो लेट्स टॉक अबाउट द कोवलेंट बॉन्डिंग इन सॉलिड्स। Covalent bonding is actually the sharing, the bond which is formed by the sharing of electrons between atoms. Last time we studied about the ionic bond, it was about the complete transfer of electron from one atom to another atom. This time covalent bond is actually the mutual sharing of electrons between the two atoms. This type of bonding occurs between two atoms of the same element or of elements close to each other in the periodic table. This bonding occurs primarily between non-metals, however it can also be observed between non-metals and metals. The ionic bond was formed by the due to the huge difference of electronegativities. For example, the ionic bond formed between the highly electropositive element of the periodic table and between the highly electronegative element of the periodic table. And the highly electropositive elements belongs to first A and second A group of the periodic table, while the highly electronegative elements includes the fluorine, chlorine, oxygen, nitrogen, etc. So in addition, the ionization energy of the atom is too large and the electron affinity of the atom is too small for ionic bonding to occur. For example, carbon does not form ionic bond because it has 4 valence electrons, half of octet. To form ionic bond, molecule should have either gain or loss 4 electron. So this is quite difficult and unfavorable condition for the carbon atom. Therefore, carbon molecules preferably share their outermost 4 valence electrons through single, double, and triple bond to complete its octet and achieve noble gas configuration. Covalent bond includes interaction of sigma and pi orbitals. Therefore, covalent bonds lead to formation of single, double, triple, and quadrupole bonds. So here are the examples of some single covalent bonds. Here we can see that the combination of two hydrogen atoms yield the single hydrogen bond, single covalent bond. What does it mean? We know that hydrogen have one electron in its outermost shell. So when two hydrogen combine to each other, they will share their electron. So after the sharing of electron, this is actually the formation of single covalent bond is formed, because only one electron from this atom and the other electron from the other hydrogen atom is shared between the two atoms. Oxygen and H2O is another example of single type of covalent bonding. We know that oxygen's atomic number is 8. So if we talk about the electronic configuration of oxygen, that would be 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 2p4. So there are 6 electron in the outermost shell of the oxygen atom. It needs 2 electron to complete its octet. So when 2 of the hydrogen atoms combine with the oxygen and form the covalent, it form the covalent bond, because this is actually not the transfer of electron from one atom to another atom, but it is actually the sharing of electrons. So this is also an example of single covalent bond. And third one is the PCl3 phosphorus trichloride. Phosphorus atomic number is 15. So 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2 and 3p3. So there are 5 electrons in the valence shell of phosphorus. PCl can also form the 5 single bonds or covalent bond, but here we are going to discuss only the PCl3 examples. So we know that chlorine have seven electron in its outermost shell, and when the seven electron it is actually the lack of only one electron to complete its octet. So whenever the phosphorus and chlorine they form compounds, they form actually a covalent bond, because this is the sharing of electrons between the phosphorus and chlorine which satisfy its octet. So let's talk about the expansion. There are expansion of octet also occurs. So what does it mean, expansion of octet? If an octet, octet means the presence of 8 electron in the outermost shell, whether by the single atom, two atoms, and sometime maybe multiple atoms. So if the number of 8 electrons increase after the stable compound formation, then this would be the example of expansion of octet. So sometime, like I already discussed, PCl5 phosphorus have 5 electrons, valence electrons in its outermost shell, so it have a capability to form 5 covalent bond with the halides PCl5. So it is actually now the 10 electron in the outermost shell of the phosphorus, because 5 electrons from the phosphorus and 5 electrons from 5 chlorine atoms. So it formed the 5 covalent bond, and actually this is the example of expansion of octet, because it have more than 8 electron in the valence shell. So if we talk about the contraction of octet, then BCl2 is a classical example of this, BeCl2. So here is only 4 electron in the octet of BeCl2 when it combined with 2 chlorine. So this is actually the contraction of octet. It is not equal to 8, but less than 8 electron in the valence shell of the central atom. So this is the example of contraction of octet. Now talk about the double covalent and triple covalent bond. So if we talk about the double covalent bond, the oxygen atom O2 is the best example for this. For example, we know that oxygen have 1s2, 2s2, 2p4 electronic configuration. So it have actually the 2 electrons need to complete its octet. So when both of the oxygen combine to each other, they claim the electron, shared electron pair, both oxygen atom claim it for themselves. So this is actually the completion of octet of both oxygen atom. So it forms the double covalent bond, because it is actually the sharing of 2 electron pairs between the oxygen atom. Same is the case with the nitrogen. So because of the sharing of 3 electron pair with the nitrogen atom, so this is actually the triple covalent bond due to the sharing of 3 electron pair between 2 nitrogen atom. So let's talk about some advancement in covalent bonds. So far the two main approaches have been used to describe and explain the covalent bonding or molecular orbital. Which one is the molecular orbital theory, and the second one is the valence band theory, VBT. Each has special features, but neither is able to explain fully all aspects of covalent bonding. So coordination numbers and shapes are explained simply and predictively using the combinations of hybridization. Hybridization ideas that we discussed already, and the valence shell electron pair repulsion Wesper theory, but these are unable to account to various magnetic properties and electronic spectra. So by contrast, if we talk about the molecular orbital theory, is able to account for magnetic behavior and electronic transitions, but it is still unable to rationalize and predict the molecular shapes. The main features of molecular orbital theory and valence band theory are described. But first, we should have to learn about some key points on the electronic structure of atoms. First is the particle wave duality, atomic orbitals, wave functions, and the nodes. Sometimes it is convenient to regard electrons as small, hard particles with definite mass. More often, they are regarded as having both particle as well as wave characteristics, in which their momentum mv and wavelength lambda are linked to de Broglie relation, which was pi is equal to h over mu, and Planck's constant h is equal to 6.621 and 10 to the power minus 33 joules second. Thus, electrons can diffract just like other wave motion. They are never exclusively particle or waves. However, as summarized in one aspect of Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which was it was not possible to determine the position and momentum of electrons simultaneously. That we have already know the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. For example, in order to see an electron, it is necessary to look at it with light of appropriate wavelength. But the electron is so small that short wavelength, high energy radiation would be required to see it. And the energy difference and sometimes the energy transfer between the radiation and electron would occur, changing the momentum of the electron. Looking at an object as small as electron change its momentum. Heisenberg uncertainty probability expression, which is the actually uncertainty in position multiplied by uncertainty in momentum, and which would be equal to or greater than h over 4 pi. This means that the consequence of increased efforts to pinpoint an electron is an increase in its momentum, or vice versa. Attempts to slow an electron effectively mean that it could be anywhere. So, given the limitations to which the position and momentum of an electron can be determined, it is usual to talk about the probabilities of finding an electron in a particular place, which is quantified as electron density distributions. Electrons in atoms are actually located in atomic orbitals, but for each orbital, all that one can state the orbital shape and the probability of finding an electron at any point in the orbital. Orbital shapes and electron density distributions are determined mathematically as solution to Schrödinger equation, which describe the wave properties of electron and accounts for quantization of energy levels. Quantization of wave motion and energy is actually, in fact, a familiar everyday phenomenon. With stringed musical instrument, only certain frequencies or energies of the resulting sound waves are allowed. By tightening the strings, this fixes the boundary conditions under which higher order harmonics can be heard. In the same way, electrons in atom occupy orbital with specific energy. The periodic table of the elements and the description of their electronic configurations and energies are a direct consequence of wave nature of electrons and allowed situation to Schrödinger equation. We shall not delve into the mathematical complexities of Schrödinger equation, but shall simply use some of the key results and consequences, so that the sign of the wave function psi represent as either positive or negative, which dictates the whether the wave function of adjacent electron are able to interact constructively as in bonding orbitals or destructively as in antibonding orbital. Note that the sign positive or the negative do not refer actually to the electronic charge. but can be linked to the relative phase of the wave motion, which changes every 180 degree. The electron density at any point is given by a square of wave function, psi square. In the simplest case of, if we talk about the simplest case of hydrogen atom with this single electron, and from which the Schrödinger equation can be solved exactly, the variations of psi and psi square as a function of distance from nucleus are shown in this picture. Actually, this is for an electron in either the ground state 1s orbital or in excited state, it may jump to 2s, 3s orbitals as well. So pi square is multiplied by 4 pi r square to represent the total electron density at a distance r from nucleus. In excited state orbitals, the wave function changes sign at a certain distance from the nucleus, at which point, known as node, the electron density decreases to zero. Comparing the different s orbitals, the electron density for one s orbital passes through a maximum at a certain distance from the nucleus. For 2s orbital, there are two maxima separated by a node, and the outermost maximum contains most of the electron density. The plot of electron density as a function of distance from the nucleus is known as radial distribution function, which is sometimes represented as RDF, radial distribution function. Although the electron density in RDF is either positive or zero, so the sign of wave function changes as an atenode, and it's provide the key to provide the resulting energies when atomic orbitals on adjacent atom interact to give the molecular orbitals. For s orbitals, which are actually spherically symmetrical, the sign of wave function is same for a given distance from the nucleus, but it is not true for p, d and f orbitals, which are not spherical. In these orbitals, the electron density is concentrated in certain regions called lobes. And different lobes for a given orbital may have different signs, as showing in this diagram. So let's talk about the orbital overlap, symmetry and molecular orbitals. Covalent bonding results when atomic orbitals on adjacent atoms overlap significantly to form molecular orbitals that extends over two or more atoms. If the signs of wave function of atomic orbitals are same in the overlap region, bonding orbital may produced. If they are opposite sign, the resulting molecular orbitals are antibonding. If the interactions are a mixture of same sign and the opposite sign, or the degree of overlap is very small, the resulting orbitals are non-bonding. Some of the general rules which I would like to describe are the number one, for example, the number of resulting molecular orbitals is the same as the number of contributing atomic orbitals. The energies of bonding molecular orbitals are lower than those of the contributing atomic orbitals, whereas the energies of antibonding orbitals are correspondingly higher. Non-bonding orbitals have essentially the same energy as the individual atomic orbitals. So the third one is the molecular orbitals in which the associated electron density is concentrated in the space between the adjacent atoms are referred to as pi orbitals, whereas molecular orbitals for which the principal overlap regions are not along the line connecting atomic orbital, referred to as pi orbitals. Before considering the covalent bonding in solids, it is very useful and instructive to consider bonding in some small molecules. So the simplest example is shown in this figure, which is about the hydrogen atom. Actually, for the overlap of 1s atomic orbitals on two hydrogen atoms to form H2 molecule, two electrons, one from each hydrogen atom, occupy the sigma 1s orbital, whereas there are no electron in sigma star 1s orbitals. We can see in this picture there is a node between the lobes of sigma star 1s orbital, which means that even if electron were available to occupy this orbital, there would be no electron density in the overlap region. Another way of thinking about the energies of bonding and antibonding orbital is that electrons in these orbital may or may not shield the positively charged atomic nuclei from each other. The shielding is quite effective for sigma orbitals, partially effective for pi orbitals, and ineffective for the antibonding orbitals. I do believe that you could manage to understand the point that I discussed. It was actually the shielding is effective for sigma orbitals while partially effective for the pi orbitals and ineffective for the antibonding orbitals. This is reflected the resulting energies of electrons in these orbitals. So when they are empty but simply provide a virtual structure with which to describe the probability of finding electrons and their energies. In molecules such as H2, is in which a bonding orbital contains a pair of electrons but the corresponding antibonding energy is empty, we may say that the single covalent bond is present between hydrogen atoms. If, however, the bonding orbital contains only one electron, as in H2 positive molecular ion, or if it is associated antibonding orbital contains a single electron, which partially offsets the pair of electrons in the bonding orbital, then the resulting bond order would equate to half of a single bond. If both the antibonding and bonding orbitals contain two electrons, there would be no effective net bonding. The molecule would have zero stability and would probably not exist. This was the case with the non-existence of helium molecule, because there was bond order is zero, unless the atoms were held together by weak van der Waals forces, your weak van der Waals bonds. So it means that if the bond order is actually zero, then this would be the indication of non-existence of that molecule. We have already discussed the case of helium He2 molecule in our previous classes, where we saw the bond order of He2, which would be equal to zero, and this was actually the quite clear indication of non-existence of He molecule. If we talk about the bond orders greater than one are possible, in which both sigma bonding and pi bonding orbitals contain electron, but without any electron in the associated antibonding orbitals. Bonding and antibonding molecular orbitals for p orbitals with their lobes pointing along the line of this one. I would like to show the example of this molecule. The bonding and antibonding molecular orbitals for the p orbitals with their lobes pointing along the line connecting adjacent nuclei are referred as sigma p and sigma star p, as shown in this figure A and B. We can see very clearly sigma and sigma star p orbitals. So for px and py atomic orbitals, which are oriented perpendicular to the internuclear line, the resulting molecular orbitals are pi p and pi p star. We can see in this diagram very clearly, this is actually the overlap of two p orbitals to give sigma p bonding orbitals in A and sigma star p antibonding orbital in B, and the C is the pi bonding orbital and D1 is the pi star antibonding orbital. So this would be all about this lecture. We shall discuss all other different different properties of covalent bond in different molecules in next lecture, inshallah. Thank you very much.